Close your eyes and imagine. What if the things in life that cause us the greatest pain, the things that bring us grief, are challenges? Challenges designed to help us grow to ultimately become what we were always meant to be. We feel like we've been buried, but what if, like a seed, we've been planted? And having been planted, we grow to become a mighty tree. Now, open your eyes. Open your eyes to this way of viewing life. Come with me as we explore your true, infinite, eternal nature. This is Grief to Growth, and I am your host, Brian Smith. Hey, everybody. This is Brian Smith back with another episode of Grief to Growth. And today I've got with me Dr. Mark Pitstick, who's actually a really good friend of mine. I'm going to read Mark's introduction, a short introduction. He's got a very long resume. I'm going to read a short introduction, then we'll have a conversation. Mark Pitstick has over 47 years experience in training in hospitals, pastoral counseling settings, mental health centers, and private practice. His training includes a pre-medical degree, graduate theology pastoral counseling studies, master's in clinical psychology, and doctorate in chiropractic healthcare. Mark has also provided suicide prevention counseling and education to many people. After working in hospitals with many suffering and dying adults and children, Mark was motivated to find sensible, evidence-based answers to the questions that many people ask. Just the little things like, who am I? Why am I here? What happens after I die? Will I see my departed loved ones again? Is there a God? If so, why is there so much suffering? And how can I best live during this brief earthly experience? Mark has written many books, has produced documentary films, CDs, experiential workshops that address all these questions and help you survive and thrive through life's biggest changes and challenges. And you can find a lot more about Mark at soulproof.com, where there's some of that information. So Mark, welcome to Grief to Growth.
It's an honor, Brian.
Yeah, as I said, you know, trying to go through your resume and through your entire background, you've done so much, you've seen so much, you know, you just made a great contribution. So where does it kind of start? Where did this drive for you to explore the big questions of life? Where did that start?
Yeah, I think it's part of my soul's mission. My parents tell me that when I was 6 years old, they were showing me a beautiful sunset, and I told them it reminded me of God. Now, we went to Lutheran church. It was always God the Father, this and that. You know, there are big paintings. He's a white guy with long hair and beard sitting on a throne. Mm-hmm. So they were perplexed as to why I would equate the Creator with the beautiful sunset. They only told me that, by the way, 20 years later when I was in theology school. And there were a couple other events where people who could read auras or see energy were like, oh my God, you know, I've only seen two of you in my whole life. And they were in their 70s. And they said, you are a blueprinter. You are a teaching soul. You're the kind of soul that rarely comes to earth. And now I can see why. And you came here with big missions. And I said, yeah, I mean, I eat, drink, and sleep it. When I was a kid, it's like I had to learn how to fit in, how to be a normal earthling, because earthly ways seemed strange to me. When I saw the Robert Heinlein book, Stranger in a Strange Land, I'm like, that's my life story. Yeah. So when I was 19, a couple things happened. First of all, I learned about yoga and meditation. And secondly, I started working in hospitals and pretty quickly got to the point where I was doing almost all ICU and ER work, cardiopulmonary resuscitation, breathing tube down the lungs, arterial blood gas punctures, pretty heady stuff for 19 and then 20-year-old. Wow. Almost every shift, I would be with one or more people who died. Mm-hmm. And seeing that, especially in the first hospital where they had a pediatric ward, seeing little kids, you know, killed in accidents or sometimes abuse, it just drove me to my knees. And everything I'd been taught, you know, God is all loving, all knowing, all powerful, just sounded like a whole bunch of BS. But it was a wonderful thing. It launched me on decades of searching. And now I feel like I have great answers, in many cases, evidence-based answers to all the questions you posed in the intro. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and it's interesting because a lot of times when people find themselves in a situation like that, it drives them the other way. It drives them to materialism or atheism, where they say, well, there can't be any meaning or purpose because I see all this suffering. I think that's kind of the easy, quick answer, but that wasn't satisfactory to you.
Yeah, it's kind of like we say in Helping Parents Heal, you know, when something horrible happens, it can make you better or bitter. And in my case, I was I call myself an agnostic, because I really didn't know. Mm-hmm. And that's one reason I went to theology school instead of medical school, because I wanted to find out for myself, what was the biblical history? You know, what was the early words behind some of these teachings that didn't make sense? You know, you shall fear the Lord thy God, and yeah, you got a loving God who would let you or send you to fire eternal hell forever. And you have obvious discrepancies that most kids spotted and said, well, that didn't make sense.
Yeah.
So I searched, and I actually kept cardboard boxes, everything I would read, think of, hear on the radio and so on. And finally, I had several big boxes of notes. And I thought, I have a book here. And that's when I wrote the first book, Soul Proof, in the late 1990s.
So it's interesting. Also, you mentioned theology school, because I've heard for a lot of people that go to theology school, that's what kicks off atheism for them. They become pastors, but they don't really believe it.
Yeah. Well, I would say most that I've spoken to, they believe in a different kind of God. You know, they reject that deistic, primitive, 2,000 plus years ago image, and see a more creative, loving force, energy. But how do most people without a background for understanding that, how do most people understand that? They usually don't have a support system for that. Mm-hmm. So they just know they reject the archaic images that don't make sense.
Yeah, you know, that's a really interesting thing. As you were saying that, I'm thinking about, but they're still teaching it every Sunday, you know, for the most part. A lot of them are still teaching this God that they really don't believe in. And frankly, it's a very primitive view of God. It's a very primary view. And you know, as you were saying how you felt growing up, that's how I felt. I was like, this world doesn't make any sense to me. And when I realized I was a separate being, that didn't make any sense to me. When I realized this God was so angry, you know, why is he so mad at me? You know, eternal hell. They're like, well, you know, you deserve eternal punishment just because of the fact you were born. I was, what? You know, I never understood that.
Yeah. Yeah. Original sin. That's another one. Just like, what? I was blessed with some clairaudient experiences. I couldn't make mm-hmm. a living on it. But starting with around age eight, I became aware of voices. And the first one was I was sitting with my family. My dad was the president of the church council, and we were very, very involved in the church. Mm-hmm. And the minister's talking about hell in the context of a fiery eternal place of torment for people who don't believe a certain way or don't do certain things. Mm-hmm. And this wise, quiet voice that I've come to equate with the voice of God or spirit, I don't see a disconnect between those two, mm-hmm. Said, Mark, they have that one a little mixed up. God has no need of such a place in his plan of salvation for all. So I turned to look at my mom and dad to see what they thought about that voice, assuming that everyone in the church heard it. And they're all just looking straight ahead at the minister. I was like, okay, what just happened?
Yeah.
But I was cool enough to know to keep it inside. And then other similar teachings about the nature of heaven and everyone having a high purpose and so on. So those form teaching points I've been trying to share with others, and also trying to internalize. You know, they say you teach most what you need to learn. So mm-hmm. It's been a lot of fun. And we live in you mentioned the ministers sharing just kind of what they're taught. That was another one, my insights. I thought, he's just teaching what he learned. It's like passed down. And the nice thing is now, 2020, we have so much contemporary evidence, scientific, clinical, and a wealth of firsthand experience evidence mm-hmm. that gives us better notions and evidence-based notions for the nature of God, the nature of life, etc.
Yeah, I think that makes perfect sense. And you're fortunate or graced, I guess, to have that early direct experience. For myself, it was a long traumatic journey, you know, out of that to where I am now. So let's talk about some of these questions, some of these deep questions that you answer on your website, like who am I and why am I here? So what are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, short answers. first of all, we're all beings of energy, consciousness, spirit, awareness. Those are different terms. I've learned so much from Dr. Gary Schwartz, as you know, a former Harvard professor, tenured Yale professor, PhD in physiology, now at the University of Arizona doing the Soul Phone Project research. He considers that we are beings of energy and information. He calls it info energy. And from a quantum physics point, from a systems theory point, you know, people like Irvin Laszlo and him and others understand that everything that ever was or ever will be is stored in the zero point field, the quantum field. Hindu wise people 3,000 years ago called it the Akashic field. Mm-hmm. And so that's there. And so that's what we really are. David Bohm, who's one of the A-team members for the Soul Phone Project, and was a close colleague with Einstein. Einstein called him his spiritual brother. He was also Bohm, Dr. David Bohm, B-O-H-M, a mentor with the Dalai Lama, who called him his scientific teacher, and close friends with Krishnamurti, a prominent Hindu teacher. Mm-hmm. Well, he merged Hindu mysticism understandings with higher mathematics and quantum physics. And he said that life is like a sea of energy. And periodically, and that's God, okay? Mm-hmm. Or that's all that is, whatever you want to call it. And periodically, there'll be a ripple of excitation on this sea of energy. Now, depending on the observer's point, that can look just like another, wow, a great experience, or it can look like, for most humans, oh my God, that's horrible. You know, I'm looking at beautiful Shana behind you. And I know it's so tough, but the human reaction is, oh my God, my daughter died. When in fact, nobody really dies. You all are soulmates. You all are beings of energy. And what Ram Dass called the only dance there is, this dance of energy, love, life unfolding, a series of adventures. So that's who we are.
Yeah, that's a great answer. I think that's and it's interesting because I'm actually reading a book by a guy right now named Bernardo Kastrup, and I've been trying to get him on my show, and I finally have him. So hopefully that interview will actually come off. And he talks about a philosophy called idealism, which, as I'm listening to it, as I'm starting to understand it, it sounds a whole lot like Hinduism. You know, the zero point field sounds a lot like Brahman, this concept of potentiality that we in the West call, you know, God, the source of everything that is the what we all rise out of and we're all part of. So it's really interesting.
It's fascinating. And the more we understand about it, the more we are free. I'm convinced that great teachers like Jesus and others were teaching this very thing. Mm-hmm. But then the powers that be took hold of it and turned into a fearful controlling mechanism to wean money from people and control them. So, you know, when he's, there's something called the Jefferson Bible that Thomas Jefferson had just the words of Jesus taken out. And that occurred to me when I was young. I was like, you know, a lot of this doesn't make sense. But then when I read the words attributed to Jesus, they make more sense. So he said, you shall know the truth and the truth shall set you free. Mm-hmm. Things like we don't really die and I and the Father are one and so are you. Follow the golden rule and so on, just really basics. But one other thing I like to add about who we are, there's also the concept of multilocation. Some people may be familiar with it through bilocation or parallel realities, simultaneous realities. And there's some good evidence for it. I first became aware of it through Native American teachings. A couple of my dear friends are Native American teachers. And oh my God, what a wealth of wisdom those people had. Had we only honored it and learned from it instead of casting them out. Anyway, I saw paintings in profile of a brave, and then above the brave, a bear, and then an eagle, and then tree, and star, and moon, and then the cosmos. And that was their way of teaching that we're not just this physical being like the brave, we're all of that. We can experience life through that. We're all interconnected and so on. So then you have people like Michael Newton, PhD, founder of Life Between Lives Therapy, and he and his team have done I think 50,000 now different cases, deep, deep hypnotic sessions with people as they have a chance to remember their time before they came to Earth. Now, these people from all over the world, they certainly didn't get together and correlate this to make up stories. And their descriptions of life before life, life between lives, is very, very similar. Well, one of the reports is that on average, only 25% or so of a person's energy, consciousness, being, soul, whatever you want, is needed to manifest in this time and place. The rest can be experiencing life through in different ways, formed or formless, and part of it may never leave home. And so in that sense, we are always with God. We are always together. That's one of the things I share when I counsel bereaved parents. I say, if you can wrap your head around it, at the same time you're grieving, and I know it's horribly difficult, but it can lighten us some to consider, and again, good evidence behind it, that you and your child might be together right now in just a very real sense as you were together before here his or her body died.
Right.
And you're looking down at this saying, wow, you know, mom's sure having a tough time with this. I hope she remembers because we planned this beautiful adventure. If she can have a breakthrough, move from a bereaved parent to a shining light parent, it'll bless so many people and it'll teach her lessons that serve her for forever. So that's how far out who we are is.
Yeah. That's, as we were going through that, I was, it's interesting to me how faith, you know, what we call faith, religion, revealed philosophy, whatever you call it, revealed knowledge, how that's starting to merge, I think, with what science is telling us. Oh, and I look at science as starting to finally catch up, right? So these mystics have known this for a very long time. We know it intuitively in our souls, and it comes up to our through our intellect, and we tell it in stories and stuff. With our Western mentality, our materialistic mentality, we've said, well, no, that can't possibly be true. And now we're finally getting the tools to find out, yeah, this stuff is actually really true.
Yeah, I encourage people to look at the contemporary evidence, and I share a lot of that in my book, Soul Proof. Dr. Schwartz and I also did in our book, Greater Reality Living, to look at the what Aldous Huxley called the perennial philosophy, the golden threads that run through all the major religions, some of which I just mentioned. And then also to trust their inner experiences, their inner voice. And I think the combination of all that, and you've got a pretty good grasp of the nature of reality.
Yeah, that reminds me, I was talking with a friend the other day who's, I would say agnostic, but more leaning towards materialistic. And we were talking about death. And she said, I fear not existing anymore. And I said, you know, I was telling her, I've worked with Kelvin Chen a little bit, and he wrote a book about overcoming the fear of death. And the first belief system he calls is the one we fear we're not going to exist. But I said to her, well, it doesn't logically make sense to fear that you're not going to exist, because if you don't exist, you won't be there to experience a non-existence. But I think something intuitively tells us that we are eternal. And so when we fear not existing, what we actually fear is like being in a void. We think we're going to die and not have any experience. I don't think we can even imagine not existing.
Well, we now know for your viewers, without a doubt, that consciousness survives after bodily death. It's not a question anymore. And so that's just part of what we're sharing. And we'll be able to make that statement even more strongly and say scientific proof in 6 months from now. So it's a wonderful time to be alive, and I hope people use that information to be free, to relax, to enjoy life. There's one other angle on that, though. You know, the concept that we create our own realities by our predominant thoughts, words, and deeds. So people who believe that there's nothing and have a certain fear of death, it's going to affect them now, and perhaps when they pass on, that will be their reality for a short time. There's some evidence that a person's belief carries over, at least initially. Mm-hmm. So they'd be like, okay, well, I'm dead. There's nothing. There's nothing because there's nothing after you die. And then I'm like, wait a minute, who's thinking? Who's talking? What's that light over there? So it's a lot of fun.
Yeah, well, yes, I've heard people have near-death experiences that do experience what they call nothing for a short period of time. And as you said, then they just kind of come to the thought, well, then if there's nothing, then who's thinking this?
Yeah.
But yeah, it's, you know, as we learn these things, you know, we can kind of chuckle about them, but it's a real dilemma for a lot of people. It's a real fear. And I've had so many people say to me, you believe all this stuff. There's no evidence for it. There's no evidence for mediumship. There's no evidence that we survive after we die. So what would you say to someone that says that to you, Mark?
Well, I would just kindly say they're not informed. And I won't use the ignorant word. I would just say nicely, they haven't taken the time, or perhaps they don't know where to get informed. And again, tons of evidence, scientific, clinical, and experiential. And let me break that down a little bit. Mm-hmm. Scientific refers to research is done in a university laboratory using control groups that's replicated, multi-centered studies. These are all big words, but important. Mm-hmm. Double-blinded conditions. And then the results are reported in a peer-reviewed scientific journal and then replicated by other labs. That has occurred now in two areas. First of all, that at least some mediums are highly evidential and the real deal, and that's reported in Dr. Schwartz's book, The Afterlife Experiments, mm-hmm. and collaborated by five different universities and four institutes. And then the second area that's been scientifically proven is that life continues after bodily death. Again, that's been definitively demonstrated scientifically in multi-centered studies now and getting ready to be at six different universities and institutes. So there's no question about those two areas, that at least some evidential mediums are real, mm-hmm. and they're really communicating with, quote, departed people, and then life continues on. Then there's clinical evidence, which are things like near-death experiences, out-of-body experiences, shared death experiences, after-death communications, et cetera. That is research done by physicians, university professors, and others in clinical settings. For example, Ken Ring, a good friend of mine, mm-hmm. professor emeritus, University of Connecticut, so Ken Ring, PhD, he and PMH Atwater have done the most research on near-death experiences than anybody on the planet. And Dr. Ring reports there are about 10,000 documented cases of NDEs. And by document, he means this. While they're clinically dead, their eyes are shut, they're not breathing, or their hearts beat, or their brain activities stop, their consciousness nonetheless continued to see events inside the resuscitation area. After a while, got bored, down the hall, on top of the hospital, outside the hospital. Later, upon successful resuscitation, without any exposure to family or friends from whom they could have learned these details, these people reported great details of what happened while they were being worked on. A doctor bent over and his pen fell out of his pocket and rolled over toward the window. I mean, how can they know this? An old tennis shoe on top. And again, if there were one of those, you could discount it. 10,000. Mm-hmm. Dr. Ring assembled a team of visual experts, ophthalmologists, and so on, to look at this question. How do you see correctly when your eyes are closed and you're clinically dead? By the way, Brian, some of these cases have occurred in people who were blind, some of whom were blind from birth. Mm-hmm. And these optical specialists said, we have no explanation for it unless indeed consciousness continues after bodily death. So I would say to those people, relax, give yourself a break, take some time, buy a few books, you know, visit my website, soulproof.com. 70 free articles, lots of free radio shows with Wayne Dyer and Michael Newton and Brian Weiss. I mean, the best of the best. So take time to educate yourself about it, because, you know, what's the saying in the Bible? Seek ye first. I'm getting teared up saying it, so yeah. It must be important. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and all else will be added unto you. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, do that. I mean, skip a little TV for God's sake. So what if you don't know the latest going on with the Kardashians? Educate yourself about who you are, why you're here, who walks beside you always, and then you can really enjoy life. It changes the whole game.
Yeah, to be fair to those people, though, we do have this paradigm where we worship scientists, and it's actually, some people call it scientism. We have this idea that, you know, it's got to come from a scientist, and most of our scientists, I think it's fair to say, have a materialistic paradigm, and it's almost considered ignorant to believe in the afterlife. And when I've approached people, and I can think of one sincere person who came to me. She was very agnostic, you know, pretty much atheistic. But she wanted to explore. Now, I give her full credit because she said, I think mediumship is fake. I don't think it's real at all. She said, Brian, tell me the best medium you know, and I'll go to them, and I'm going to prove it's fake. So I gave her the name of my friend, Carolyn Clapper, and she had a reading with Carolyn, and Carolyn made her a believer. And so, you know, and I've had people come to me and say, well, Brian, there's no evidence of any of this. And I'm like, I send them to soulproof.com, or I tell them about Gary Schwartz, you know. And I'm like, I read the afterlife experiments, 20 years ago, I think it's been now, right when it first came out. And I was stunned that it was actually a researcher that had taken mediums, and I don't know how many blind levels it was, 3 or 4 levels of blinding, where the medium never met the sitter. And the person with the medium didn't know who the sitter was. And the sitter didn't know who the medium was. And nobody knew anybody. And these guys were getting evidence that you know, you and I would call proof. Gary would say it's a strong indicator, I guess. But and I would call proof that mediumship is real.
Yeah, 90% success rate for these mediums versus 23% for the control group who didn't have any, at least, developed mediumistic abilities. Mm-hmm. And as you say, his research was observed by a team of scientists, magicians, videographers. No one could find any flaw in the methodology of the practice. Sometimes the mediums and the sitters were in separate rooms. The mediums didn't even hear the sitter's voice. The experimenter would answer back and forth for them. So yeah, it's there's no question about it. Well, isn't it like a lot of things that we pay for not being open? You know, for example, let's say a person was brought up thinking that you should only stay with people of your own color and everybody else is bad. Well, if they believe that, they're going to cut themselves off from a wealth of potential relationships with people of all shades, same way with people of different sexual orientation, religions, cultures. So people with closed minds who don't venture out and question for themselves and oftentimes trust their inner voice pay for it. And that's a form of hell, by the way. Mm-hmm. You know, hell isn't just hell in the original meanings, meant how you feel when you have your life review and look at what you did to others and what you thought and said. Well, every day we have a life review, whether we're aware of it or not. Mm-hmm. So one of the biggest reasons to expand our mind, expand our world, search for good answers is to enjoy heaven now and then after we pass on as well.
Yeah, that's an excellent point. And I think the farther I go in my life, the more I think if there's one problem that the world has, the biggest problem is that we've forgotten who we are, that we think we're a biological accident, that life has no meaning, that the universe has no meaning, that we were made conscious when we were born, and when our body stops functioning, we lose consciousness. And I think that's at the root of every single problem that we have as human beings on this planet.
Yeah, and Einstein referred to that belief that we are separate from life and others as an optical delusion because we depend on what we see. There's only one little problem with that. And this is one of the things that Dr. Schwartz and I discovered when we were starting to work together. I had used for years analogy from Lynn McTaggart's book, The Field. She interviewed top quantum physicists, and they said that if all the light and energy, again, that's the most absolute nature of reality, if all the light and energy in our world were the size of Mount Everest, the portion the average human can perceive with their 5 senses would be the size of a golf ball. Mm-hmm. Well, Dr. Schwartz had a different metaphor, but very similar. He said, if all that exists in our world were the height of the Empire State Building, the portion the average human can perceive would be the height of a coat of paint. So those analogies, based on good science, point out to people that you can't go by. I mean, didn't everybody hear in a little, there's more to life than meets the eye?
Yeah.
We'll get back to Grief to Growth in just a few seconds. Did you know that Brian is an author and a life coach? If you're grieving or know someone who is grieving, his book, Grief to Growth, is a best-selling, easy-to-read book that might help you or someone you know. People work with Brian as a life coach to break through barriers and live their best lives. You can find out more about Brian and what he offers at www.grieftogrowth.com, www.grieftogrowth.com, or text GROWTH, GROWTH, to 31996. If you'd like to support this podcast, visit www.patreon.com/grieftogrowth, www.patreon.com/GRIEF2GROWTH to make a financial contribution. And now, back to Grief to Growth.
Yeah.
You know, but yeah. People just think it's some old homespun phrase. And so I say most people are going around looking through a tiny pinhole, mm-hmm. and they think, and they can only see such a fraction of all the reality. So they think, oh my gosh, my loved one died, or oh my gosh, I have cancer, I'm going to die. God, why is there forsaken me? Oh, there's probably no God anyway. Life is so, you know, we just get in this. It's all in our mind, all this. Life is cruel, unfair, random, and chaotic. Mm-hmm. And none of that's true. And so that's why it behooves people to take a little time, do centering practices like meditation, yoga, time in nature, playing with people or pets, basically whatever helps quiet the brain, because the brain is the culprit. Evan Alexander, a neurosurgeon who wrote Proof of Heaven, and I were talking, and we both agreed, he is a medical neurosurgeon, I have as a doctor of chiropractic, mm-hmm. that based on our understanding of the central nervous system, 95% of what our brain does is inhibit, filter out sensory input. Mm-hmm. Because if we could see, hear, feel, smell, everything exists, we'd be inundated, we'd be schizophrenic, we couldn't function. Mm-hmm. And so evolutionary-wise, it was adaptive for us just to see and hear things we needed to survive. Saber-toothed tiger growling, the difference between the poisonous berries and the good berries that we could eat. Mm-hmm. Well, now, though, it's become a detriment in the 21st century. And so that's why it's wise to take some time to expand that valve a bit, even if you see a quarter-size portion and mm-hmm. look around more. Then life starts making so much more sense, and so does a person's earthly experience.
Yeah, I remember when I first met you, it's been 3 or 4 years ago, and you were giving a lecture here in Cincinnati at the Victory of Light, and you gave that analogy about looking through the peephole and the Dakota Paint and the Empire State Building, and I've thought about that ever since. And so as I've, you know, we can look and just give some people some ideas. Like, for example, we can only see a small portion of the light range. And I shouldn't say visible, it's visible to us. But like bees, for example, literally see a different world than we do. Bees, when they look at a flower, they see something. And I've seen some photography that kind of tries to simulate that. And it frankly looks like what people describe in a near-death experience. It's like they're lit from within. So, and when we think about what we can hear, I mean, we can only hear a small range of what's going on. And dogs, for example, they experience a different world than we do. So we're so arrogant thinking that we can see and hear everything. And even with our instruments, we're like, well, surely with our instruments, we can see and hear all that there is. But we know that even that's not true. We've got this dark matter and dark energy that we know exists because it has to exist, but we have no way of sensing it.
Yeah, that's science. And so for people who think there's no science behind what we're talking about, it's just not true. By the way, I'd like to sidebar real quick and share with people the first time we met. As Brian said, he and Ty was with you, and it seemed like it was one other person with you.
Yeah, we were somebody. I can't remember. I think it was Wendy at the time. Yeah.
Okay. So they came to one of my talks. There were maybe 90 people in the room, and I'm getting ready and I'm getting in the zone, because when I have a chance to teach, I just like say, okay, God, you know, tell me what to say, how to say it, and when to say it to reach the most number of people deeply. And so I'm walking down the aisle, looking at people and kind of reading and seeing where people are. And all of a sudden I look over to the left and there's Brian and Ty. And I'm just like, whoa, do I know these people? I could feel your presence. Mm-hmm. I could feel your energy. And just locked eyes with you for a moment. And then, you know, the rest is history. And we got in contact and been working together.
It's so wild, Mark, because I had read one of your books or I'd heard your name or something, and but I didn't know really who you were in detail. So we were late to the Victory of Light, and our friend had shown up because she was late. So we were waiting. And I said, oh, Mark Pitstick is speaking, you know, because we were going to go just walk the general floor until the next session started. I said, Mark is speaking right now in the room down the hall. So it's like, you know, I want to hear him. So we walked in, and you, as you said, you and I met, and we've been working together pretty much ever since on the soul phone, helping parents heal, et cetera. So this is one of those things in life that was just meant to happen.
Yeah. Yeah. And I encourage people to watch for those signs. You know, it's important that we have kindred spirits. One of the big things I hear from people is they say that they've had personal experiences. Maybe they glimpsed someone who passed on, or they felt like their consciousness detached from their body for a while. But they are afraid to tell others, family or friends, for fear of being considered kooky. Well, first of all, there's a very good chance that one or more of your family and friends also had those experiences, and they're also in the closet about it. But one of the reasons we're forming the Greater Reality Living Groups, and I encourage people to join enlightened places like Unity Centers and others, mm-hmm. is so they meet kindred spirits. People are open-minded, open-hearted, service-oriented, and then you don't feel so alone. And that brings up a good point we should cover. Again, based on Michael Newton's work and some other clinical evidence, it appears that about 85% of the people on this planet right now are what are termed beginner souls. And it's not a judgment. It's just the state they're at. You know, judging them would be like putting down a one-year-old that can't walk yet.
Yeah.
And then another 12% or so intermediate souls, and just 2 or 3% advanced. Well, people watching your show likely are advanced mm-hmm. and intermediate. And I just wrote an article, for example, number 67 or something on soulproof.com about optimal relationships for more evolved people. Because living on Earth is very tricky in a number of ways for people who are partially awakened. And that's why it's important to have kindred spirits, to take better care of the physical plan so you're personal energy and your body and brain are more on the same wavelength, et cetera.
That's a really good point. You know, it's interesting. I've heard something similar to that before because, frankly, a lot of us, the people I hang out with, like yourself and other, we look around the world, we're like, what is wrong? Why don't people get this? Why are we fighting? Why aren't we taking care of each other? Isn't this obvious that, you know, we should be doing better? And that's, I guess, a great explanation. I think we're all, I mean, the thing is, we know we're constantly evolving, and we know there's always going to be someone who's ahead of us, and there's always going to be someone who's, you know, behind us, for lack of a better way of putting it. But Earth seems to be kind of a beginner school. It just looks that way to me, too. So that makes sense to me.
Yeah. Years ago, I read a channel book by Pat Rodegast for a collective entity called Abraham. And he said, do not mourn, and this is paraphrasing, but do not mourn for the suffering you see on Earth. Where else would souls go to learn basic lessons? And so, yeah, this is like kindergarten in the universe, but important. There's one other thing that I encourage people to consider, and I just wrote an article on this, about contrast souls. So things are not always as they seem. And this is why we just have that, okay, whatever, you know, I'm going to look for the silver lining here, no matter what happens, because there's some good evidence, and I present some of it in the article, that some people who appear to be ignorant, cruel, etc., are actually more evolved souls who are purposely taking on, out of love, a limiting outer countenance to push people's buttons, to trigger people to do work that they wouldn't have otherwise if they hadn't met this, quote, you know, mean and bad person. Same way with people who are really sick. I forget where I was reading, but the the report was that some higher souls, sometimes even guides, will agree to come to Earth with, again, just part of their energy and be a really sick, invalid person. Mm-hmm. Why? So beginner souls can learn to be doctors and caregivers. So that's, you know, when you get this kind of information, again, with some clinical evidence behind it, that's when you step back and say things like, it's all good, it's all God. Or Dr. Schwartz and I were talking the other day about the saying I heard from the teacher Ram Dass, suffering is grace, suffering is bliss. You know, those kinds of seeming paradoxes. And again, it allows us to relax, do what we feel we came here to do, enjoy life, and don't worry about it. It's like the Jackson Brown song, in the end, it's a blink of an eye. And it truly is, whether we lived 105 or 5 in the span of eternity, which mm-hmm. is forever.
Yeah, that's an interesting perspective. And I was going to ask you, the next question is, you know, why is there suffering? But I think you've already started to touch on that, you know, because people will say, well, if there's a God, if there's a loving, all-powerful God, then why do all these bad things happen? And we label these things as bad.
Yeah. I remember when I saw the movie Oh God with John Denver and George Burns, and, mm-hmm. you know, John was asking him those questions mm-hmm. as God. And I think I even quote this in my book, Soul Proof. And George Burns, as God was saying, I don't create the suffering. I don't allow the suffering. You do. You know, I gave you this beautiful planet and everything on it. Now it's up to you to love one another, or to kill one another. So God is not a puppet master, a dictator, a robot maker. And God is, again, not a big guy in the sky. We're all part of God. We're interconnected. So that's one reason they're suffering, because humans create it. Mm-hmm. Another is, and Buddhists probably said it the most succinctly, why is there suffering? Two reasons: opportunities to grow and to serve others. Mm-hmm. Now, because if life were perfect and easy all the time, most of us wouldn't dig deeper, learn, and we may not be motivated to then reach out and serve others, just like you've done, as a way to transcend your grieving.
Yeah, I don't know if I came up with this or not, but I had this thought experiment that I would do with myself and say, okay, what if the world were perfect? If everything were literally perfect, every wish I had was fulfilled the moment it happened, nothing caused me any, nothing contradicted any of my wishes. It wouldn't be real, because there'd be nothing outside of myself. As soon as there's anything outside of myself, it's going to contradict, you know, what would be perfect to me. So I would be, there'd be no experience. And so I realized there has to be some level of what we call suffering or imperfection in the world for us to even experience anything. So then the question only becomes, well, what level is acceptable? So people will look and say, well, this level is certainly unacceptable. You know, yeah, this is too much. But I looked at, like, if you look at a toddler, for example, when they fall and they skin their knee, they think they're dying. They literally think it's the end of the world. Or if I were to tell my daughter, Shannon, you can't have ice cream today, you can have ice cream tomorrow, you know, she would think I'm the cruelest father ever. So what I realized is we're basically like big toddlers. We say, okay, this world is just, it's just too much. You know, I could see God allowing a little suffering, but not this much. But it's really limited, because we're only here for a short amount of time.
And language is so important here, specific language, because it seems to me, I just finished reading a book by Bernie Siegel and his grandson, and it's called What If Everything Is Really Perfect? Yeah. And it's based on a saying by an anonymous person, is when you realize how perfect everything is, you'll raise your head up and laugh at the sky. Yeah. And it really is. So from the big picture standpoint, you know, if we're seeing everything, mm-hmm. we see it's perfect. But when we're looking through even a quarter size, there are some areas that certainly don't seem perfect. So that's the task for the awakening person, to take this incarnation seriously, to have compassion for others, to do what we can to alleviate suffering, and at the same time, remember the big picture. And it's tricky. It's been compared as like walking on a razor's edge.
Yeah, I was talking with a client the other day, and I was just telling that same thing. It's about balancing. And it's about, so when we get too far on the everything is perfect, it doesn't matter side, because it's all going to be okay in the end, then that makes us no earthly good. And that's not what we're here for. But when we get too far down in the weeds and say, it's terrible, I can't stand it because it's the worst thing ever, we've got to move back towards the other balance where we take that higher perspective. So being a human is a very difficult thing to do.
It is. And, you know, we don't have documented evidence for this, but I've certainly heard it said from different sources that there's a long waiting list among souls to come to Earth because it is such a intense experience. It does provide such diverse ways to grow. I mean, it's one thing to be in a focus group in a spiritual realm. And how can I work on myself? You know, it's all hypothetical.
Yeah.
When you come down here and the rubber hits the road, that's when you find out how much you really know.
Well, we've touched on it a lot, but I want to talk about Soul Proof because there's such a wealth of information there. You've talked about, how many articles are there now? About 70?
Yes.
So there's all these articles, and you've got CDs, you've got experiential things that people can do. So talk people through what they'll see if they go to soulproof.com.
All right. Yeah, there's three areas of free resources. I try to make all this affordable as possible to people. Mm-hmm.
You do.
So all these articles covering all the bases, you know, most of the scientific evidence that life continues after bodily death, the clinical evidence, an article for bereaved parents, when your child changes worlds, when your loved one's body is murdered, when a loved one's physical form dies by suicide. By the way, notice some of my language. It sounds cumbersome, but I never say when you die, when your loved one was murdered, because you can't die. Your loved one couldn't be murdered. Mm-hmm. However, your loved one's physical shell, earth suit, we call it, can be. So articles on just about every conceivable question you could ask to answer the biggest questions and challenges people have during their earthly experience. Secondly, as I mentioned, lots of free radio shows. I hosted a radio show twice, and just gems, the top minds in consciousness and afterlife studies, free newsletters. So those are the free. And then books, but they're all very affordably, like $15, you know, for the books. Mm-hmm. Audio products, as you mentioned, 12 different ones. The digital downloads, $14.95. I mean, this is, and what a person gets from that would cost you $250 with a therapist one-on-one, but it's like having me in the room where I take a person in the deep hypnosis, deep relaxation, and do things like past life regression, mm-hmm. pre-birth planning, identify your soul's missions. What would your life review be like today if you died, and how can you change it so when you do pass on, it's a work of art, etc. So there's a explanation of each one of those products. Then I do coaching and counseling, and I have to charge something for that for my time. Mm-hmm. So those are all the resources out there for people.
That's excellent. Yeah, and I've learned so much from your books and gone through some of your workshops, you know, with you. You've given so much time to helping parents heal, helping, you know, walk parents through those things. So for people who haven't had that opportunity, this is a great way to get to some of Mark's wisdom and knowledge at soulproof.com. So we have to talk, Mark, we have a few minutes left. We have to talk about the soul phone. So people, first of all, explain to people what it is. I'm the VP on the board. You're the director of the soul phone, but Soul Phone Foundation. Let's talk about what the soul phone is.
How many minutes do we have?
We've got about 10 minutes.
Oh, okay. I thought you said two.
No, we got 10 or 15 minutes.
Well, the Soul Phone Project is based on research done at the Laboratory for Advances in Consciousness and Health at the University of Arizona. Dr. Gary Schwartz, I mentioned, is the director of it. He has a team of electrical engineers, software specialists, optical physicists, evidential mediums, and other experts who help him with his research. He started, we mentioned his work with evidential mediums, mm-hmm. 20 plus years ago. Well, 20 years ago, he started getting tidbits of information from some of these evidential mediums independently. They would say, Gary, Albert Einstein keeps coming to me and saying, you're supposed to build technology to allow communication in between dimensions. And after several years of that, then he started working on his very first experiment in 2004, measuring different ways to capture the signal of spirit and create even basic yes, no binary communication with them. Well, now in 2020, we're working on what's called the electronic soul switch, which is a binary indicator, and there's different ways it can be done. But we're working on now an instantaneous 99.9% reliable and accurate switch that people, post-material persons, people in the next realm can touch or influence to answer yes or no. That in itself has limited usefulness, but the beauty is that this switch is small enough that can be created then in parallel with 40 other switches to create the soul keyboard, allowing texting and typing, again, with loved ones, and then also with post-material luminaries, a team, we're told, hundreds and hundreds of scientists, inventors, people who are geniuses on Earth, very dynamic people, and who have learned a lot during their time in an obstructed universe and want to help us here on Earth. Once we have the soul keyboard, Brian, as you know, then we're off to the races. We will have a much better quantity and quality of information coming in to develop then the next two devices, soul voice, like a cell phone, soul video, just like we're doing now, Skype, Zoom, Facebook. The ultimate goal is to have an app, applications that will work with any smartphone so that people can talk with and see loved ones, and also attend webinars given by these visionary luminaries. The goal for the soul video is to have a 3D holographic form, so it will be the next best thing to the person really being there, because you'll be seeing solidly, and match used in some Las Vegas top clubs entertainment now, and they're quite real. So that's the soul phone project in a nutshell. It's yeah. happening. We appreciate funding that comes in. We have had a number of visionary donors who, and almost all the team is, all of the team is volunteer. Dr. Schwartz and his wife, Rhonda, have not received one penny. I've been working about 50 hours a week for 4 years, not one penny.
We have
our team of volunteers. So nobody's getting rich off this. Nobody's making anything, but it's a labor of love. I mean, it's how else could you make an impact on so many people in our world potentially as this? So we appreciate funders. We know it's just a matter of time before we receive large funding. I mean, we're only talking about $2 million or something to complete the electronic soul switch. And then perhaps that again, to have a commercializable soul keyboard. So it's really not that much money. It's a matter of time before somebody learns it. What's coming up is multi-center studies. I mentioned earlier, by the end of this year, having had the research replicated by six different universities or institutes, Dr. Schwartz's third peer-reviewed scientific journal describing all this. And then the beginning of next year, using the electronic soul switch, what we call seed events, which stands for soul phone experience ethics demonstration. So these will be public demonstrations, probably virtual now, where people will see this technology working, see the results of it. Also launching during that time what are called hope sessions, which means have opportunity for post-material experience, which means individual clients can interact with the technology and get yes, no answers from their, quote, departed loved ones who are standing right beside them. There's so much you can do with yes or no. For example, you can ask 20 different questions. Half of the answers should be no, half should be yes. And the computer could show photos. So you could say, is this a picture of our dog when you were little? Answer is yes. Is this a picture of a birthday party we had last week? Answer should be no, because there was no birthday party. You know, did we go to Disney World for your 16th birthday? Yes or no, where the answer should be. So at the end of 20 of those questions, when they're answered 100% right, it's kind of like that Demi Moore moment in the movie Ghost, where she sees the penny floating in the air and like, oh my God, this is really real. And yeah. then that's that spiritually transformed experience that awakens a person's heart, opens their mind more, and then you know, usually they're off and running, just like near-death experiences. Then they're less altruistic, materialistic, they're more loving, the more giving, more peaceful, etc.
Yeah, one thing I want to say, because as people are hearing this, I'm trying to put myself in the mind of the public. It may sound fantastic. It may sound, you know, unbelievable. So to relate it to some people, if you've had signs from your loved one, like Shana messes with my cell phone, or if you've seen lights flicker in the house, or if you've heard of instrumental trans communications or EVPs, all these things that have been documented that have been going on for years, where spirit has been interacting with just normal devices. As we've had electronics, there's been a lot of this. So what I try to tell people, imagine you build a device that's highly sensitive just for this purpose. And then that's what Gary has been working on. And we've already got results. I mean, there's already results that you said that are out there, but it's coming. It seems too good to be true, but I think it's really coming, you know, in a very short period of time.
Yeah, it's been a little frustrating. You know, we've been working on this for 3 years, getting the word out, and we'll get emails from people say, "Well, the soul phone ever really be, ever really happen, or is this a bunch of BS?" But keep in mind, we've been trying to do this on a very small budget, part-time electrical engineers, part-time software programmers. And so a project that could be done in a week by a full-time team may take months by these part-time people. But one thing about Dr. Schwartz and I and others, we don't give up. And we say we've already had the Wright brothers moment. There's some beautiful writings by Wilbur and Orville Wright after the first flights at Kitty Hawk. You know, the first one only lasted 18 seconds and then crashed. But they wrote, "We now know that human flight is possible." There's no doubt in their mind. Five people saw that first event. Mm-hmm. Well, we've already had our Wright brothers moment. We already know that life continues after bodily death, and communication with them, albeit at a basic level, yes, no, is possible. Now the goal is to have a commercializable, practical, usable device, and that will change the world. By the way, in our book, Greater Reality Living, I share an interview I had with one of the mediums in which I was purportedly talking with, because you have to say purportedly because we don't know 100% for sure, but with Albert Einstein and Nikola Tesla, Carl Sagan. And I asked, once we have even the soul keyboard, are you all willing and able to give webinars for us on our toughest subjects, you know, global sustainability, race relations, optimal leadership, addressing hunger, overpopulation, et cetera. And everybody knows the list. Would you all be willing to give these webinars? And the medium started laughing and she said, they're pushing each other out of the way to get first in line. So that's how much they're excited to share what they know. And again, it's just a matter of time before we have that technology in place. So I hope this gives everyone peace, hope. Things are going to get better, and things can get better right now. It's an inside job if you know even a fraction of what we've been talking about.
Yeah, you know, as we're talking about this, I'm thinking how, as mankind, I think we've kind of come full circle. I listened to some teachings from Emanuel Swedenborg, and he talks about there was a time in man's history where when people went into the spirit world, we could still see and communicate with them easily. And then as we became more and more materialistic, we started losing that ability. And I think we're almost kind of at the abyss now. We're at the low point where we're so materialistic. And so maybe instead of religion, you know, being the thing that leads us back to remember where we are, maybe it's this, that we can really, you know, fully understand who we are. So I know there's a tendency, I think, from some people to say, well, this is not possible. This is not meant to be. Are you trying to play God? You know, the veil's there for a reason. You know, you might have those types of thoughts, but I think it's something that's really needed. Because we're just about to destroy our planet. I mean, we're really on the brink right now.
Yep. But it's not too late now if we take action. You know, you were talking about there was a time, Swedenborg saying, there's still time in other cultures that aren't so focused on materialism like we are. my fiance Andy works at a children's hospital, and one of our coworkers is from Jamaica, and they've become really close. And this woman said, "Yeah, I dreamed my grandma up last night." And Andy said, "Wait a minute, you dreamed your grandma up?" "Yeah, you know, I called her in spirit."
Mm-hmm.
"And like, tell me more." "Oh, she died a while back, but I just dial her up and we have these wonderful talks and visits." So that's part of the culture there, part of the understanding. And
yeah,
that is possible. And now we're going to have the technology to do it for everyone, even if they're totally closed down. I mean, if you can work a cell phone, you should be able to work a soul phone.
Yeah, well, yeah, that's a good point too, because I know like Sonia Rinaldi is doing work where she's communicating into the spirit world, and people ask me about her and how does that relate to the soul phone. I have a friend who's a physical medium. He can talk to spirit over an Apple Watch. He's figured out how to make Apple how to talk to spirit over an Apple Watch, and he's got a microphone he can talk to them on. But what I've realized with those, they're physical mediums, and that's my belief with Sonia Rinaldi, because I can't take Sonia's equipment and replicate it. I can't do what she does. But with the what Gary's working on with the soul phone project, this is independent of the operator. So it doesn't require someone to be whatever a physical medium is. They're bringing something to it that spirit is working through their body.
Yeah. Obviously there's been good results with different EVP and ITC mm-hmm. approaches, but as you say, sometimes it's operator dependent. Sometimes the results are hit and miss. You may not get anything. Some of the audio recordings are so garbled that you need a subscript to supposedly understand what it says.
Exactly.
But likewise, visual images. The goal here is to have 99.9% safety, accuracy, reliability, clarity, just like we're used to now with technological devices.
Yeah. Well, I just want to say one more thing about as we are, because I was at Kitty Hawk last year, was on vacation, and I went by Kitty Hawk. And I know you and Gary always use that analogy, and seeing where they took off and seeing the museum and seeing the first plane, and then thinking about where we are today with rockets and jets and stuff. I mean, that's kind of where we are with the soul phone. More than that first flight, we're past that even, but you know, it'll develop over time and it'll become, you know, it's going to become ubiquitous, I think, at some point in time.
Yep. And I hope people are inspired by these analogies and begin flying themselves. You know, we each are special souls, special beings who came here with gifts. And again, this is the Native American teaching. This, each one of us has a giveaway. Hmm. And I've seen it for many years as life is like a puzzle. And when we each contribute our part, do what we came here to do, the pieces of the puzzle come together and we can have heaven on earth.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, Mark, I could talk to you all day. We said we'd go about an hour, so we're at an hour now. I really appreciate you doing this. It's been great catching up with you.
It's an honor to be on here. Thanks for all you're doing, Brian.
Anything you want to say in closing?
Just the websites again, soulproof.com for my information. To learn more about the soul phone, soulphone.org, soulphone.org, and learn about it, share about it with others. Take it within, internalize it. We've mapped out how to do that, and enjoy your life. I look forward to seeing you someday somewhere.
Yeah, thanks, Mark. You have a good weekend.
All right, you too, my friend.
Bye. That's it for another episode of Grief to Growth. I sure hope you got something out of it. Please stay in contact with me by reaching out at www.grieftogrowth.com. That's grief, the number two, growth.com. Or you can text the word growth to 31996. That's simply text growth, growth, to 31996. Since you're watching this on YouTube, please make sure you're subscribed. So hit the subscribe button and then hit the little bell here and it'll notify you when I have new content. Always please share the information if you enjoy it. That helps me to get more views and to get the message out to more people. Thanks a lot and have a wonderful day.